So today we are going to have Sayeed Choudhury joining us on the open source movement and AI. So I'm going to tell you a bit about Sayeed and hopefully he's not blushing too much. Sayeed is the Associate Dean for Digital Infrastructure and Director of the Open Source Programs Office at Carnegie Mellon Libraries and an affiliated member of the Block Center for Technology and Society, as well as the Executive Director for the Open Forum for AI. He is the director of an Alfred P. Sloan, I hope I've said that correctly, Foundation Grant for Coordination of Universities and a co-investigator for the Black Beyond Data Project. Choudhury Sayeed is a member of the Open Source Initiative OSI Board and Human AI Collective Advisory Group. He is a software area expert and a member of the Steering Committee for the Research Data Alliance, RDA. Thank you, Sayeed, so much for joining us.
So hopefully you can see the opening slide to my talk, which is the open source software movement and AI. As Claire mentioned, I'm based at Carnegie Mellon University and I have various roles that she's already described. So I'll get right to the topic at hand. Some of you may not be familiar with open source programs offices or OSPOs. It's still a fairly new concept within the university sector. This is the screenshot from the webpage of Carnegie Mellon's OSPO. And fundamentally, an OSPO is a unit that is focused on open source software, which is increasingly becoming an important part of digital infrastructure. It's important to note that we do not see the OSPO as owning open source software within the university, but rather being a community convener and a center of competency and a first stop, not necessarily the only stop, within a university setting to learn about open source software, both within Carnegie Mellon, how it's being used, how it's being shared, and then the impact of that software beyond Carnegie Mellon. So the OSPO is a concept that's existed in the private sector for several years, but it's still fairly new to the university sector, something on the order of maybe 3 or 4 years, but it is a growing movement in a very fundamental way, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as well. Essentially, it's a clearinghouse or a lighthouse within an institution, and its main function is to help identify, manage, share open source software, both within and beyond, in our case, Carnegie Mellon, but any institution. So many of you have certainly, I assume, heard of open source software, but as Claire mentioned, I'm a member of the board of the Open Source Initiative. So in that context, I will say that there's actually an official definition for open source software that is maintained by the Open Source Initiative. And that definition is expressed through a set of licenses that are also managed by Open Source Initiative or OSI. And a really important point is the so-called freedoms that are associated with open source software. And those are the ability to use, to share, to study, and to modify the software. So if you put your software on a repository like GitHub, that's a useful and wonderful thing to do. But if it doesn't have a license that clarifies those uses, those freedoms and so on, it's not officially open source software. And that might seem somewhat picky or pedantic or so on. But the reality is that by having those legal expressions, it allows greater participation, greater innovation, greater use, greater sharing and so on. And this is significant in the sense that a Harvard Business School study, which is at least a year out of date at this point, indicated that the benefits from open source software in an economic perspective is almost $9 trillion, $8.8 trillion of economic value, and that it's reduced the production costs associated with software by a factor of 3.5. So well beyond the university sector, the academic sector, open source software has become a really critical part of economic activity. What this slide shows is three outputs from typical university setting. On the left is articles, in the middle are data, and on the right are software or code. Over the last decade within the United States, there have been a couple of memoranda from the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, or OSTP. The first one is the so-called Holdren Memo in 2013, and then more recently in 2022, the so-called Nelson Memo, those people just being the directors of OSTP at the time. And what those memos focus on is so-called public access. And the idea is that the outputs from federally funded research should be made available publicly. So US tax dollars are basically being used to fund the research that's taking place, the argument being therefore taxpayers should have the right to see those outputs. And in a fundamental sense, if you think about these two memos in 2013, 2022, they've been moving from left to right on this diagram. The first one really focused very much on articles. The second one really focused much more. It made some additions in terms of articles, but really focused much more on data and didn't explicitly call out software, but does mention it. Many of the federal funding agencies consider software within their provisions for data. There are multiple reasons why it wasn't much more clear, one of which was the concern about whether universities would have the capacity to respond. And we think that OSPOs can, in fact, help build that capacity. So the movement has clearly been towards data and software. And then I think that the OSPOs are well positioned to respond to these memos. One other way of thinking about an OSPO is that if on the right side of this diagram, if you had a series of arrows, that would basically be impact that come from open source software. That is what an OSPO is fundamentally focused on doing. I'd mentioned that this is a growing movement. So there's a new network called Curious, which is the community for university and research institution OSPOs. Claire mentioned that I was the PI of the grant from the Sloan Foundation to help launch Curious, but it is now functioning on its own. Some of you may know Claire Dillon, based in Ireland. She's basically the lead for Curious, along with Richard Littauer from Sustain OSS and one of their colleagues named Kiara Flanagan. So Curious is now up to 20 institutions. There's 17 within the US and 3 within Europe, 2 in Ireland and 1 in Luxembourg. And we have become a network, and we are starting to share information with each other, produce outputs together. And this is becoming a very valued network of colleagues and information sharing that is raising the collective capacity in a nonlinear way in terms of OSPOs within universities. Some examples of the things that we do within Carnegie Mellon through the OSPO, and some of these overlap with other Curious members, but some Curious members are doing things that are unique or not directly related to the activities of Carnegie Mellon. So having that complementary set of expertise and capacity has been very helpful. I won't go through all of these in detail, but I'll just pick a couple. One of them is the licensing best practices, and I listed CTEC, sorry for the acronym. That's Carnegie Mellon's Technology Transfer Office. And we worked with other Curious members to, in essence, find out what their technology transfer offices and others recommend in terms of licenses for open source software. And then we pulled that together into a document. And our colleagues at Georgia Tech in the OSPO there developed a very useful flowchart, basically, that you ask a series of questions. And it takes you through a set of pathways in terms of choosing a license. We've all been very clear in saying that we're not lawyers, we're not technology transfer, we're not trying to provide definitive legal advice, but faculty and administrators have clearly stated this as a need, and it's now a shared resource that can be used to help with those kinds of conversations. I'll also mention the Summer of Code course. I've been working for some years now with an individual named Stephen Wally. He's an executive in Microsoft's Azure office, and he's been teaching a software engineering course with open source software essentially as a laboratory. So with a few key open source projects, the most recent iteration, the projects came from the Eclipse Foundation, came from Red Hat Linux, and so on. Students are immersed in those projects. They work with mentors from those projects, and they make contributions directly to those open source software projects. And it is basically providing a very important real world grounding in how software development works at scale in the private sector in particular, but certainly sometimes in the government sector and so on. And we're finding that the students have an acceleration in some sense. Of their understanding about how software development actually works beyond what they might learn in the classroom setting. In 2023, it was taught in Pittsburgh with a computer science faculty member named Michael Hilton, and then this past summer taught at Carnegie Mellon's campus in Qatar, in Doha, with Eduardo Flushing, a faculty member based there. We are now looking to have another iteration of this at CMU's campus in Kigali, Africa. In addition to those types of activities where we've focused very deeply, if I can put it that way, in terms of working with a few individuals, we're now starting to think about services that can be deployed across the entire university and can be operated at scale. One of them is Viturgia, which is an analytics platform, in essence, assessing the quote health of your software project. There's a set of metrics from the Chaos Group, which is community health analytics for open source software. And Viturgia provides a very nice visual interface to examine who your contributors are, how often they're contributing, how often issues get reviewed, how often pull requests are reviewed, and so on. And that's all done through a dashboard so that you can have a visual representation and make queries against that. It's a great way to understand, where are the dependencies of your software coming from and who's working on it, and are there some concerns in terms of sustainability or not? Another example is called SCARF, and this is a tool that's used for more downstream type of analysis of who is using your software. In many cases, you may know, but in many cases, you probably don't. One of the beautiful things about open source software is literally anyone can come along and use the software and either use it on their own or make additions to it, add to your project. And SCARF is a way that we can start tracking that downstream usage. And we're starting to find projects at CMU that basically say, I didn't realize so and so was interested in my project, or I did, but I didn't realize they were using it in this way, and so on. And those two services in particular are important for this next slide, which is about moving open source software projects into community-oriented products. I've mentioned Stephen Wiley at Microsoft. It has been a great education for me to work with Stephen and learn from how the private sector and the private sector foundations, open source foundations like the Eclipse Foundation or Linux Foundation, do this work. And fundamentally, there's a lot here, but fundamentally, the main premise being that a project within a university, often with grant funding, external funding, is typically a group of known individuals working together and working on the code and then pushing that out to others to use. The phase change or the transition that happens when you move to a community-oriented product is there is still that sharing outside of the team of developers, but now you start getting contributions from other people, people you may not even know. And this is the way in which these projects can scale. And this is the way in which these projects can get the kinds of contributions you need to make it sustainable beyond the grant funding for an original project team. And this is not a trivial type of process. It's a very significant one in many cases. And as you might imagine, in a university setting, there's no one particular roadmap or one particular blueprint to do this. The nature of the projects is very different. The size of the projects is different. Some of them are educational, some of them are research-oriented. Some of them have no intention of trying to build thousands and thousands of developers contributing or millions of people using it. So the scale may be very different. So we're exploring what all of this means in the context of trying to do this kind of project to product transition within a university. And a few examples to talk about, these are projects being run by faculty members at Carnegie Mellon University or CMU. One is Penrose, which is very much an application which is used to draw diagrams. It started with math diagrams, but as you can see, it's evolved to things like proteins and any kind of scientific diagrams you might want to draw. Another is something called the Open Energy Outlook at the Scott Institute at Carnegie Mellon. They have an open source project called TOMOA. It's an optimization model to track the impact of different kinds of policies around energy. It is open source software, and they're interested in working with the Department of Energy on this. And then something called the Spiral project, which is much lower in the stack. This is a signal processing open source software tool that looks at, the performance of hardware systems and so on. So we have projects at all sort of layers of the IT stack that are open source and that are looking for this kind of community transition. And you're not meant to read or understand this. I'm simply just showing you this screenshot of a spreadsheet. And that one of the things I had mentioned is we're trying to identify all the open source projects at Carnegie Mellon University. And we're working with an individual named Jonathan Starr, who works for NumFocus, and also with other curious members who are doing similar types of work. And in our very first pass, we identified only on GitHub, so far, about 5,500 possible open source projects at Carnegie Mellon. We've done multiple iterations at this point to, you know, hone down that list and then filter it down to what we think are the actual projects. But even if only 1% of this initial list are Carnegie Mellon projects looking for that phase change from project to product, we're talking about over 50 projects. So this is a significant amount of activity or effort that would be required to make that happen. And in that regard, we have launched something we're calling the Engine Software Foundation. Engine stands for the Ecosystem for Next Generation Infrastructure. The premise being that open source software is a key part of next generation or digital infrastructure, and that there are multiple projects at Carnegie Mellon that wish to go through this transition from project to product, and we need to create a foundation to make that happen. Now, there are several reasons why faculty at Carnegie Mellon have included that the existing foundations like Apache Foundation or Linux Foundation or Eclipse Foundation work for certain cases, but do not work for all of them. And that's why we're exploring what this means to do this out of a university. We have funding from the provost to have this launched, and we're actually talking to a couple of other funders about possibly supporting this as well. But over the next couple of years, 3 years, we're hoping to launch this into an official entity that will be doing this work, certainly for Carnegie Mellon open source software projects, but perhaps even beyond that. And of course, there's a lot of interest for this around AI as well. As Claire mentioned, I've been involved with the open source initiative, which led an effort to develop what we call the open source AI definition. And in a fundamental sense, the OSAID, as we call it, is affirming those four freedoms I had mentioned about open source software: the ability to use, study, modify, and share. So can we build those four kind of freedoms into AI as well? I will say the definition is in essence a legal and developer-oriented definition, because those are the two communities that Open Source Initiative has most contacts with. But that AI is, of course, an order of magnitude more complex than software. So that we are going to have to think about what those differences mean in terms of translating or migrating what we did with open source software. This is just a screenshot, a capture. I encourage you to go to the Open Source Initiative's website and look further of the definition. Probably the most, quite frankly, contentious, controversial component of this is where we landed in terms of data. The definition does not require that all data be shared for training. There are multiple reasons for that, but does in fact require sufficiently detailed information about the data. There are legal reasons and privacy reasons that one may not be able to share the data, but there's no reason why you couldn't provide the detailed information. And so the definition has been released as of October. We do not believe that it is permanent. We do think it will evolve, but we felt it was very important to have a stable definition, particularly given the interest in open source AI. And I will also mention that the process under which we developed this definition was very inclusive. It was a co-design process, which is a new way for OSI to engage communities, actually. And we engaged new communities who we never worked with before. There were over 160 people from five continents, a great deal of representation in terms of gender, race, and geography, as I mentioned, but even academic backgrounds such as academia, private sector, nonprofits, and so on. So we feel that that's a very important foundation from which we can work. And there have been some prominent endorsements, I'll put it that way. This is from the Mozilla Foundation blog, and they endorsed the definition, spoke very highly of it, and I highlighted one sentence in particular from that blog post, which says that, you know, this new definition is a critical juncture in the evolution of the internet. I'm not the right person to answer with that's an accurate statement or not. But I do think that last sentence, that it's important in terms of shaping the future of this technology, its impact in society, is right on the mark. So this open source AI definition is playing a key part in these conversations, including within the European Union, where the AI Act states open source AI as a provision for less regulatory burden, if I can put it that way, but doesn't define it. And even within the United States, there have been multiple agencies, memos, so on that mention open source AI without defining it. So we felt it was really important to put a definition out there from which we can work and try to have these conversations around policy and re possible regulation. Not everyone is a fan of the definition. In particular, Meta has used the term open source AI repeatedly and used it to describe its own llama models. This is a piece from The Economist, which basically talked about the definition, talked about Meta's response. There are other individuals and other organizations who may share these opinions, but I will say that most of the big tech feedback that we've received is more nuanced, in the sense that even if they don't believe or support the definition, they respect the process under which we came up with the definition, and would in fact like to continue to engage and see if the definition could evolve or how it could be tested and how it could be used for evaluation purposes. So fundamentally, it is a legal and developer-oriented definition. What CMU and other institutions are trying to do is now build the bridge towards engineering evaluation and aspects of what that definition means. What does it mean in terms of safety, responsibility, transparency, lack of bias, and so on? And that very much leads me toward the Open Forum for AI, which is something that we launched this past July. OFAI is being funded by funds from the CMU Library Reserves and also from the Omidyar Network and the Nobel Reach Foundation. If you're not familiar with those two entities, they are started by people from the VC private sector, private equity world, but have nonprofit philanthropic wings. And that's what we've been working with. The major overarching goal of OFAI is to bend the arc toward more human-centered AI, by which by which we mean that the people who use and are affected by AI systems are the ones who should be able to evaluate and affirm whether they are in fact safe, without bias, responsible, transparent. We are in a world where the developers of particularly the large language models keep putting out new releases. We respond, we react to those. We don't do a lot in terms of evaluating them against these key issues for societal impact. And we'd like to shift that from a reactive to a more proactive stance, where we say, here's what we think an open, responsible system looks like, and here's what you should be your target. The open source AI definition will play a key role in that, but I think we'll need something much more robust and much more comprehensive, what we're calling an openness in AI framework, something that looks across all the components and stages of AI, and asks those questions about what does openness and transparency get you in positive senses of innovation and participation and so on, but also in terms of the evaluation for the things that could potentially be harmful with AI. A key part of that will be to engage the university sector. So if my research area is digital infrastructure, if you look at the internet and the web, there is basically a triad of industry and university that work together to develop those. But even starting with the web, and certainly with AI, the role of the private sector has grown with AI in very high proportional ways. And I'm not assuming that's good or bad. I'm just saying it's an observation. I happen to believe that having more balance between government, industry, and the private sector is worthwhile. So OFAI is led by CMU, but we have Georgia Tech, George Washington, and the University of Texas, Austin through the OSPOs at those institutions as partners. We're hoping to engage more universities to raise the voice of universities as a sector in terms of thinking about openness and the trajectory of AI. Open Source Initiative is a partner. And we also have the Atlantic Council, which is a policy group based in Washington, D.C. So these are some of the individuals leading our working groups. So the work that we do will be through this comprehensive strategy of interrelated research, technical prototypes, community engagement, policy, and talent for service. So Hoda Hodari is the co-lead for the Responsible AI Initiative at CMU. She's the lead of the research group, which is focused for now very much on safety, evaluation, and openness, particularly as it relates to innovation. Ben Shah is the head of the technical prototypes group. Essentially, can we build open small language models and use those as a means to work on specific types of curated content and specific use cases and a pathway for greater community engagement? So Deb Bryant at OSI, who's been involved with the open source AI definition and the policy work of OSI, both in the US and Europe, is the lead for that group. Trey Herr works at Atlantic Council, who'd be the advisor for our policy recommendations group. And Rachel Zombach is another colleague of mine at Carnegie Mellon in the Heinz Policy School, who's leading what we call a talent for service track, which is how do you identify talent, build a set of educational curricular resources to give people a more systems view of AI, not only a technical view, but a socio-technical view, one that has an understanding of impacts and societal connections and so on. And then place them in the public sector. And that work is directly being funded by the Nobel Reach Foundation, who I'd mentioned previously. So we are still fairly new. We are working on our position paper. Should be ready. It will be ready before the end of the calendar year. So once it is, we'll share that very broadly. It encapsulates some of the things I've described, but goes into more detail. We are actively involved in policy discussions both within the US and Europe. We're trying to have some events around the Paris Action AI Summit. So we're getting the word out and we're trying to engage more partners and more members in 2025. We'll hopefully have some of that activity happen. So I'll just end with a few acknowledgments for those who are funding or supporting our work, and be happy to take any questions if we have them. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sayeed, for an overview of everything you've got going on. It's great to hear about your work and the initiatives. And I'm interested in the open source. And are the OSPOs that you see, are they all based in libraries or are they in different areas of institutions?
They are not all based in libraries. I started the one at Johns Hopkins, and I started the one at Carnegie Mellon, along with my boss, Keith Webster, who's the Dean of Libraries. So the ones that I started are libraries. And there are certainly libraries involved in multiple OSPOs, but one of the actual intentional premises of Curious is to try different models. Is to have some of them connected to the research computing or the supercomputing entities like UT Austin, Georgia Tech. Another is to have them within a research center. Stanford has that model, for example. Others are tied directly to the Office of the Provost. Others are tied to the undergraduate studies and so on. So we're experimenting. I don't mean that in a bad way. We're experimenting with different models, and we're learning that there are different benefits, pros and cons to having different organizational models. But I think over time we'll get a better sense of where it makes sense, particularly from a sustainability perspective, right? I think we've all started with grant funding, at least the current Curious members. I do know there's one or two institutions that have started without grant funding at this point. But once that grant funding ends, of course, we'll need to think about how to sustain them over time.
And I suppose if we sort of those of us who don't have them, we're thinking about how we can promote and support open source. And I think particularly when we look at, as you said, that movement from open access to other types of open with research data, but open software, et cetera, and open methods. I suppose what would you say to those of us who maybe haven't got a grant to go forward and how we can sort of take some of the work that you've done forward or think about how we can embed it in our institutions?
Yeah, it's a good question. So there are some lessons we can take from the movement around the data management services that many of our institutions now have. Maybe not all, but many do. Also started off as a small movement. Again, I mean, I was at Hopkins, we launched research data management services there. The one thing that I think is common is on that slide is that they're both primary research outputs. Right. So if I were to ask people at even CMU, a place that's immersed in open source software. Do you care about open source software? I would get a wide range of answers, right? But if I said, do you care about the research outputs of Carnegie Mellon? You'd be hard pressed to find someone who says, no, I don't care about the research outputs of Carnegie Mellon. And in fact, you'd probably say, why? You should care about the research output. So making it clear that this is not about open source per se, but that it is about research, it is about education, it is about what we call translation through tech transfer. And that open source is a great way for those things to happen or to be done in new ways, innovative ways, amplifying the impact and so on. I think that's a common message, right? That many institutions, research intensive institutions would resonate with. But that's also something about curious is we have different kinds of institutions, R1, R2 in the US, sort of research levels of research activity and so on. But I will also say there's some important differences, right? So the public access memos did mention data specifically. That has a very important, network effect in the US, particularly with the funders. But I'll also say that software and open source software have different social norms and different levels of expertise. I know it's a gross generalization, but I think most faculty would say that they're more comfortable managing their data than they are managing their software. Not to say they can't produce software and they can't put it out on GitHub, but I know it's anecdotal to me, but I think this is true within the Curious Network, for example, is more of them are willing to share their software without a mandate, without a policy driver, or so on. There seems to be more of a willingness to put your code out there than put your data out there. And then once the code is out there, there seems to be more of a willingness to say, well, I don't actually know what I'm supposed to do next. I don't have a clear plan for patches and updates and maintenance. And I don't have a good way of responding to this person who came out of nowhere and just made a contribution, committed something, and they have a pull request, and I'm supposed to do something about this now. And we've actually heard quite the opposite in some cases that when a very well-meaning faculty member somewhere, instructor somewhere, says to their class, "Hey, there's this open source project. Let's go in there and help it," right? And suddenly that project is receiving all these requests that they never anticipated. And the graduate student who wrote that code is gone. These are scenarios most faculty don't want to deal with, quite frankly, right? And if an OSPO can be a place that at the least advises how to manage that kind of scenario, and maybe over time can even provide support, the CMU OSPO is basically me and Tom Hughes, our community manager. We're not providing a lot of technical support, but that's true of some of our colleagues. I suppose in the Curious Network, St. Louis University comes to mind, where they're providing technical support. So the OSPO can be a place that provides a lot that range of support, which faculty I think are eager to get. I think that if your institution produces software, again, which I think most do, the latest estimate is that 96% or 98%, I don't remember the exact number, of all software uses open source. And something like 80% is actually released as open source. So those are some of the arguments I think that will span lots of context.
I know, having written open source myself, that you're doing it in a small group, and then when somebody finds it, you're like, oh yeah, they found it, and it's like, oh no, what? What's in my code? What's it look like? What are
Be
they going
careful what
to
you wish for.
do? It's like everything, isn't it? We've got a question in the Q&A, and this is about sustainability and the role of OSPOs, and how they can link academia to industry. And I think that was really interesting, how sort of spin outs and things, but also how you support people in open source in that sense, and how we can use them to promote new studies and initiatives, and particularly around climate change as well. Thank you, Lucy, for your question.
So in terms of the engagement with industry, The way that that typically happens in US universities has been through these technology transfer offices. And I will state very clearly that it's important to have a good relationship between your OSPO and whatever your technology transfer function, office, entity, individual might be. When I arrived at CMU, I was introduced to the head of CTEC, our tech transfer office, and it was a great conversation. But he basically said, I have two questions for you. One is, are you going to tell everyone to open source everything? And I said, no, I wouldn't presume to do that. I wouldn't presume to tell the faculty just about anything. But I don't always think it's a great idea either. There may be some cases where it doesn't make sense. So I am not someone who's going to show up and just tell you everything should be open source all the time. And then once we pass that bridge, he then said, are you going to make license recommendations? I said, absolutely not. I'm not a lawyer. That's not my expertise, so on. So it's really important to have that connection with them. But what I will say, it crystallized for me with literally one exchange with a faculty member where I will point people to tech transfer. They will point people to the OSPO. We have got a very good kind of, bi-directional relationship there. When he said, tech transfer will be helpful for me if I want to commercialize the IP around my software, right? But if I want to build a sustainability model that may include commercial options and not change the IP provisions of my software, then tech transfer isn't the right place for me. That may be true to CMU, but I think it's true in other places too. So we have very much approached industry engagement through the OSPO as an additional pathway to industry engagement. So there may be existing ones. We're not trying to say you shouldn't use them or that they're not good or anything like that, but it's an additional way. I will say, as neutral as I've, sort of tried to be in that whole explanation, I think open source software is a great way to engage, right, outside of universities. So the irony is universities typically have only legal ways of working with each other, grants, memorandum of understanding, data use agreements, business associate agreements, lots of three-letter legal documents that you sign. Those are time-consuming and they can be burdensome, right? Open source software is a much more frictionless way to work with other people. As I mentioned, it is actually a legal assertion. You could put a license on there, and in essence, to express, even from a legal perspective, what you're expecting and what you're sharing and so on. But it allows you to work with other universities. It allows you to work with private sector. It allows you to work with individuals in a way that is very, very different than the other ways we have, right? So we just had a panel at the Linux Foundation Summit in Europe this past September about academic and industry engagement through OSPOs. And what's interesting to me is the industries, at least the ones that were on this panel, have started to shift their way of working too. What they basically said is, we now understand why you were so caught up about publishing rights, right? The ability to publish papers. We didn't get it initially, but now we do. We understand why you're so caught up in these following issues around the licenses for your code and so on. So I think we're starting to infect in a good way the private sector as well about how you want to work with us around these particular types of issues. So in terms of sort of this, the new initiatives around climate change. I'd mentioned the Scott Institute's work around the Open Energy Outlook and TMOA being one of these models that is directly applicable in the context of climate change. So, as obvious as it sounds, one thing we're trying to do with this inventory of open source software is classify it into different sort of facets, right? Are these research projects, education projects? Are they STEM? Are they humanities? And so on. And one of those facets could certainly be climate change, right? So identifying the projects that exist in your institution that are, broadly speaking, supporting climate change would be important. And again, faculty don't necessarily think this way. I was speaking with a faculty member about the work he's doing and how important it is toward the Sustainable Development Goals and sustainability and climate change. He said, I'm not sure about that. And I said, you are building open source, open hardware sensors that monitor air pollution. It is literally one of the SDGs. It's, I forget the number. I went dot, 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 is literally that. And he went, oh, okay, I didn't know that. So helping them understand that their work they're doing actually is connected is critical. And then the last piece I'll say is Open Energy Outlook is hoping that TOMOA can be used by the Department of Energy. We could try to sign an MOU with the Department of Energy, or we could say, hey, here's an open source software platform. Here's the license. How do you care? Do you care what license we choose? We'll choose the license and then we'll work on it together. I think that's a much preferable pathway.
Probably quicker.
Probably quicker as well.
And a lot of what we talked about has been software in research, but obviously there's opportunities to use software in running our universities and things as well. And I suppose, is that linked to the office as well? Sort of how you adopt and run open source software within the institution?
It hasn't been at CMU, and I, you know, I wouldn't say that it's something we'd rule out. Certainly, if our computing services or our student enrollment or our, you know, educational groups said, "Hey, we're thinking about this open source software, or can we make our software open source?" We would absolutely work with them and try to help them through that process. I'm not aware if that's happening within Curious. That's a good question, and I can ask. You know, once I'm done with this webinar, I will ask, and if I hear from others about that, I'll certainly share that with you.
I think that's a really interesting one as we look at the future of our repositories and other systems that we have as well, about how we take them forward and opportunities to work together, as you said, between libraries as well. I know here at Leeds, we work really closely with our White Rose colleagues, and we have a shared repository which is made possible, through the open source solution that we use.
So that's a good point, that some of the infrastructure used to support scholarship is open source. And that's true in many of the Curious members.
I'm just going to sort of give a prompt. Has we got any more questions from you all sitting in your offices at home?
Yeah, anything on the AI side in particular?
And are you looking into AI about sort of, creating language models, and especially, I suppose, small or large language models, and how we can do those together, especially around open content? I think that's interesting,
We,
sort of seeing the content our researchers produce, our
yeah.
research outputs being fed in to these language models as well.
Yeah, we are. The Vince Shaw, who I'd mentioned from Dietrich College, has been leading that work, and he's developed a whole suite of these small language models. And they range from something called Socratic books, which in essence allow an instructor to use their own content and then through what's called retrieval augmented generation, get other kinds of relevant content, put together a book, a digital book, for lack of a better term, and then have lessons, learning lessons attached to that, and then have the students interact with the Socratic book bot one-on-one. And what I find fascinating about it, so I'm not an expert in pedagogy, but he's talking about Bloom's famous 1984 book, but basically or article that in essence said that one-on-one tutoring, mentoring is still the most effective way to learn. So this is emulating that experience. And in essence, what I guess this will sound strange, to me was the really amazing moment was it's being used for a course on machine learning and AI. And what Vince was showing me was, you know, here are the learning objectives and so on. And then he types, "I'm a fan of Iron Man. Can you describe this to me according to Iron Man?" And it immediately says, "Yes, of course. Jarvis is the expert, you know, system," and so on. And it used the metaphors of Iron Man to help explain these very complex concepts. So it is a way to customize, personalize spontaneously the way to these very difficult lessons using whatever metaphor you want. And it's being used at Carnegie Mellon right now. And the question is, sorry, the evaluation of it will take place in the spring semester as well. And then there's operational gaming environment, which is about negotiations. So how does the bot help different people negotiate, maybe even adversaries negotiate together? There's several of these kinds of small language models we're building.
Yeah. And I see William. He can take like power over. I'll let you put your chat in the chat, William. How can we best support our staff in open source AI and the skills they need? And I know this is something we've been discussing at Research Libraries UK around sort of digital skills and how we support people as well. And we had a session in last year's about that and how we support people developing those skills in practical ways as well. Because I think that's often where we hear talks about what's happening with AI and ethics, et cetera, and then you go back to your desk and it's like, well, where do I start?
So there's two things I'd say to that. One is just as you pointed out, is just practical. It's just use it. I know that sounds silly and it sounds almost, ridiculous, but I'm struck by the number of people who still have not used it. And I don't mean just use it once and walk away. I mean use it as part of your daily life. And I also don't mean just at work. I'll give you a very real example. I have a porch back here, and I was buying some furniture for it, and I measured the space very carefully in terms of what I could fit. And I did what I used to do, which is go to Google and start searching for places that have furniture with those dimensions. But then I would be oriented to the website or directed to the website, and then I have to use all the filters of length, width, whatever. And this was very frustrating and it was not working. So I literally asked ChatGPT, can you point me to outdoor patio furniture that fits in the following dimensions? And it gave me a list of 12 options. That saved me hours of time in the old way. I'll say old way, but that's still the way I still do it. Most people still do it. So just use it for your everyday experiences. Carnegie Mellon signed up for enterprise licenses. So if you're concerned about data protections and so on, your institutions can broker licenses that make that more, amenable to protecting data and so on. But even the commercial ones that are available, free ones that are available, it's worth using them. And I'm finding more and more that my first choice for any kind of search is, in fact, AI right now, rather than Google. And it may seem like a strange metaphor, but to me, something like ChatGPT is to Google what Google was to Yahoo when it first came out, right? Yahoo took a very library-based approach to organizing the content in the web. And then Google came along and, in essence, learned, or not learned, but took advantage of the fact that a digital piece of content can be in multiple places at the same time. It can be anywhere. And what's more important is how often it's, quote, connected, or cited. So I think we're experiencing something similar like that. So it may seem, and that there's no harm, right? If you use the thing and it doesn't work and it doesn't get you what you want, who cares? Try again. Prompt, the way you enter your prompts does matter. So that experimentation is important. At the other end, I would actually suggest people learn a little bit more about how these things work from a mathematical perspective, right? And I'm not talking about taking a statistics course. I had the benefit of, I didn't think so at the time, of working on stochastic multi-objective programs is what they were. I'm not suggesting everyone do that. I was trying to simulate hurricanes. But there's a course called Elements of AI that was put together by the University of Helsinki, I think. It's a really well done primer on how these models actually work in terms of demystifying them, that they are, in essence, math engines that recognize patterns really, really well and assign probabilities to those patterns and weights to those probabilities and so on. I think just any opportunity to learn how they work and demystify them will be helpful, because right now I think a lot of people feel like this thing is magic. I don't know how it works. It's almost spooky. Yes, William, I think
Yeah,
that is in
William's
fact
posted.
the right link. Thank you for that. So and I will say I've had stochastic programming training, and I didn't get 100% on these tutorials. Okay, so don't feel badly if you take this and you don't. We may have many A students on this webinar. You may feel like, oh my goodness, I didn't get 100% of it. Don't worry about it. That's not important. You're not getting a grade. You're not getting a certificate or anything like that. Just go through the course, learn how these things work. it's very illuminating in a powerful way.
Yeah, I went to a talk earlier this year, and they were saying, if you're doing a trip, ask one of these AI tools to sort of plan to you, going, oh, you know, for me, I'm vegetarian, I'm here, these are the places I go, this is how far I'd want to travel, and it will give you a great itinerary of what you want to do in a few days. And I
Absolutely.
thought, I hadn't thought of that. I was just thinking, you know, I'd have to go plan all that myself. And I suppose it's those
Absolutely.
examples, which is good just to give you things, and then go back and say, and we've linked some references. And then you
Right.
just get all of that information that you would have had to search through over so long together. And then you can go tweak it and ask it to refine it. It was a really, yeah,
And
good prompt for me of
it
things I
may,
could do in every day.
yeah, and it may seem a little bit, as I said, somewhat unnerving. But I, as I've been doing this, I would do things like try to find restaurants in a city that I'm about to visit, and I would have Google on Google Maps, and then an AI bot, and I would be doing all this. And I was really taken aback recently when I was asking about restaurants, and it gave me, and I said, find restaurants within walking distance of my hotel, and it gave me a list. And when I looked on Google, I saw one that wasn't listed and so on. And I said, why didn't you list this restaurant? And ChatGPT wrote back, well, you didn't tell me what walking distance is, which is fair. I did not specify what walking distance is. I will tell you that I told the system I'm happy to walk up to 1 mile. And it's never asked me since. So one of the interesting things about AI is it learns from us and we learn from it. And that dance is going to be interesting over the next few years.